told his captain that a man was nothing but a man. Before he'd let that steam drill run him down, he'd fall dead with his hammer in his hand.
Hey y'all, here we are, and I just wanted to take some time out and answer some questions that I get asked frequently. That's right, this is a bit of a Q&A session, and one of the biggest questions I get asked constantly is, what is your dream camera? What's the end goal? What is the one to rule them all? And it's a fantastic question that I believe a lot of people on YouTube or in social media, whenever they ask this question, they answer it wrong. I'm sorry, but they answer it wrong because they come back with this answer of like, what's your dream camera? Oh, it's a Mamiya 7 or it's a Leica 6. And that's it. And it's just, why? Why? Oh, I just always wanted one. That, oh, it just leaves you deflated. No one wants to hear that. They want to hear the juicy story and everything. So I've got an extremely long-winded story to what my dream camera is, and it's not going to be whatever you think it could be. I promise you that. You're going to want to stay for this one. The plot twist is going to get you, right? What's my favorite camera? What is my dream camera? No, they're two different questions. Sorry, they're two different questions. First, let's answer, what is my dream camera? Okay, that's the first question. And if you haven't already noticed, get comfortable. This is going to be a long video. This we're talking about dream cameras, okay? We're talking about lots of questions here. It's going to be a big rant, okay? It's going to be a good old chattosaurus, okay? So get comfy. This is going to be a big one. All right, here we go. Dream camera. Starting now. What is my dream camera? I love this question because it gets me excited, and I think it gets everyone excited, doesn't it? When you ask someone what their dream camera is, it gets excited. You think, oh, if I could have anything in the world, what would be my dream camera? You start to think about, you know, if money's no limit. And it's funny because as you play through this exercise in your head, it's actually a really good question to ask yourself, because no doubt the answer is going to continually evolve and continually change. But also, it helps to really help you understand what it is you value in a camera and what it is you value in photography. So my dream camera, you're going to hear me say that a lot of times through this video. Okay, what would my dream camera look like? Well, my dream camera would be a film camera. Okay. And it would be all mechanical. Okay, so that already rules out a lot. Why? Why would it be a film camera, and why would it be all mechanical? Because one, I don't want to say too much and edge onto other videos. So I've got to be careful what I say. Dream camera. Okay, so why mechanical, and why film? Because, again, I don't want to go too much into other videos, but film, forget about the look of film. Let's put that aside, because if you want to argue that film is easily replicated now with modern digitals, I'm not gonna fight that fight. Okay, yeah, they are getting very, very good. Modern digital cameras are getting very, very good at replicating. I still think film looks better, but anyway, let's leave it as it is. But the difference between film and digital is I find film a lot more engaging and fun to use. I find it way more engaging, way more fun to use. Whenever I use a digital camera, it feels like I'm working. It feels like a job. It feels like, you know, like if you're gonna compare it to a situation, it's like if you were a courier driver, and as a courier driver, you're driving like a van. That van, and you said to them, oh, how much do you enjoy driving that van? That person would look at you and say, It's just a job. It's just a van. I'm just a courier driver. I don't really care. But then get the same guy, person, and putting me in, you know, a nice luxury, you know, vintage car, and wow, it becomes an experience. It becomes part of the journey. It becomes something to celebrate rather than just an everyday thing. So yeah, for me, digital cameras are just work. It just feels like work. Don't enjoy it at all. So that's why I would go film for that point. Film, because it's way more enjoyable to use. Now, why mechanical? Why fully mechanical? Well, these cameras are getting old, and the last thing I would want to do is get a dream camera, like, let's say, a Mamiya 7, and then the thing just dies. I couldn't handle that. I couldn't handle having a dream camera that just, well, even more than a Mamiya 7. What about an X-Pan? Oh, I'd love an X-Pan. That's definitely up there on the list of dream cameras, is the old X-Pan. I'd love an X-Pan. But it's gonna die. Like, it's gonna die, and you can't fix it. That's it. Throw it in the trash. And I can't live like that. Like, I just can't live like that. I need to have something that I know I can repair. And that's because, and it leads into the next point of what is this dream camera, leads into the next point. My dream camera at this stage, right now, as I'm recording this, as far as I can put my finger on it, my dream camera would be the Wide Lux, right? The Wide Lux. Is it called an F7 or something, or F8? The Wide Lux. That would be my dream camera. It's mechanical. It does a wide format shot. It's unique and different. It's an experience to use it. Shoots film. What's not to love? Okay, and what I really love about that camera as well is that it's basically a point and shoot. No focusing, nothing like that. You're not changing f-stops. All you're doing is picking a shutter speed, and you just go into town. That's it. I love that. I love that. The camera gets right out of your way, and it just does what it's got to do, and you just mitigate the situation of light as best you can, and enjoy the ride. I love it. So that would be my dream camera as it stands, would be a Wide Lux. It's a point and shoot. It's basically a point and shoot. I love that about a camera. Make it simple, make it fun, make it an experience, and make it mechanical so I can fix it for years and years to come. Now, why do I like that? Why the Wide Lux? Why the Wide Lux? I hear you say. So I first heard about this camera through T Hopper's video that she made, which is a fantastic video, highly recommend. If you haven't watched it, gotta watch it, man. And that's what I love about T Hopper. It's the kind of channel where you can learn about stuff you probably would never think to even sort of research, but there she is giving you some really great information. Fantastic channel, really, really cool stuff. Anyway, she did a video about the Wide Lux and how it relates to our friend Jeff Bridges, who I'm a massive Jeff Bridges fan, thinks he's a legend, he's an absolute champ, right? And what I love about that camera is that that became his iconic camera, okay? That became his iconic camera, and he uses it, and it's his thing, and it's his little niche, and he's gotten some banger shots, like some serious bangers with that camera. And I think what I love about that story the most, what I love about this whole idea behind this camera and behind Jeff Bridges and behind all those bang images, is this simple thing. And this is why I choose a mechanical camera. There is nothing more exciting than buying a new camera. And if you're watching this channel, then you understand what I'm talking about. What's not exciting is having the same camera forever and ever and ever and ever and ever. That's not exciting, because it gets boring, because it's the same camera and you get to know all its quirks, and then you get to figure out its quirks, and then once you've figured it out, the excitement starts to wear off, and then it's just another camera, and it doesn't twinkle as much when you look at it, when it sits there on your shelf, and you're like, yeah, I've shot with that for like 2 years now. But see Jeff Bridges with his camera, it keeps going. It's his camera. Like, that's his one and only camera that he's just going to shoot with for the rest of his life. You know, I'm sure he shoots with other cameras, but what I'm saying is that's his, like, his main jam. That's his main, you know, thing. And I think when I talk about my dream camera, more than the Wide Lux is the thought of just being so infatuated with the camera that it becomes your main camera for the rest of your life. That's what I want my dream camera to be. So yes, it's the Wide Lux, but it doesn't strictly have to be the Wide Lux. What I'm really in love with is the idea that sticking with a camera for a huge, for your whole journey, sticking with one camera for your whole journey. If you stick with one camera, you get to know it better than any other person on this earth. It becomes part of your journey. Like, let's think about it, right? Let's say you picked a Holger 120N, right? Humble camera, and you went out and you bought 14 of them because you knew they were all going to die, and You bought a whole bunch of them, right? Your whole bunch of film, and all you did is shoot with that one camera to the point where you learned all its quirks. You learned which lenses worked best. You figured the thing out so much that you were just one with the camera. And you had such an amazing catalog of images that eventually people called you, you are Mr. or Mrs. Holger. Like, you are. And you get a little letter from the company and they'll be like, oh, I just wanted to reach out to you because we noticed that you're predominantly shooting just on a Holger and your projects have become world famous and wow, what you've been able to achieve from that, blah, 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 we're going to make a special edition cop. Okay, maybe I'm going a little bit over the top, but you see my point. You see my point. If you stick with one thing and don't give up on it, just stick with it and lean into it as hard as you can, all of a sudden you become that thing. Like, you become the one person who repped that one item. That became synonymous. You can't speak about the Wide Lux without talking about Jeff Bridges. And that's what I'm in love with. That's what I think is just so cool. And when we talk about dream cameras, that's what I want. I want to have a camera that I just stick with forever and ever and ever, that it becomes synonymous with me. And when someone thinks of, oh, that camera, they think, well, have you checked out Shutterslaps? That guy pretty much invented the camera in the sense that he stuck with it. He's created amazing work with it. He's well known for, you know, troubleshoot, like everything. I think that's super cool. I think that is the coolest of the coolest. And I know there is some YouTubers as well. I don't even know if they're YouTubers, but I know there's some other people. There's a guy in Australia, I think it's even in Melbourne, and he just does SX70s. Like, he fixes them, everything, and he's just Mr. SX70. And like, if you ever wanted to know anything about that camera, he's the guy to talk to. You know, and it sounds so simple, but I just really look up to that. I really value that. I think just pick one thing and be awesome at it. Instead of trying to, oh, I'm good at photography and these are all these, no, just pick one camera. Just pick one camera and just stick with it and learn everything about it. And when you think you know everything about it, you don't. Start fresh, try something different. Try a different feature in the camera you've never tried before. Try a different film stock, try a different way of shooting. Just do everything to the point where you know that camera so well that it's a part of you and it's a part of your story. And eventually you'll be looking through old photos of you getting older and you keep holding the same camera. And people have got photos of you, like family photos, or, you know, just you and your mates hanging out. Same camera every time. Same camera, same camera. And then one day you retire when you're like 100 years old and that was the camera, you know? That's what I want. That's what I want. So what I'm saying now is, yes, the Wide Lux is my favorite camera. But what I love is what the Wide Lux taught me, which is Jeff Bridges sticking with one camera forever. Then that takes me on a tangent, which makes me think any camera could be a dream camera as long as I can stick with it. As long as I can stick with it forever and ever and ever. And it becomes synonymous with me and it becomes my go-to bit of kit. Okay? And it comes with me everywhere. See, the problem is, when I think of a camera, I think of something that travels with you. Always. It's by your side. It's always by your side. It has to be by your side. That means it needs to be able to handle wherever you are. But also, it needs to be something that you can take with you all the time. And for me, like a Leica or something like that, I just couldn't do it. I couldn't. I'll be honest with you. If I had a Leica, there's no way I would have it sitting in the car next to me every day when I go to work. There's no way. It wouldn't make sense. I would keep it on my shelf. And then when it's like a nice lazy Sunday and I'm like, oh, let's go to a farmer's market and get some asparagus, I'd be like, I'll bring the Leica with me and we can, you know, go get coffee and brunch and we'll go check out that new cafe that's on the other side of town. And you bring your Leica with you and you take a few snaps and you feel great. I'm not having to go at anyone like that, but that's just not going to work for me. I want a camera that's battle ready, can sit in the car next to me, get banged up, scratched up, don't care. No one's going to steal it because it's probably worth nothing. If it breaks, I can get it repaired. That's what I want. So as much as the Wide Lux is my dream camera, the issue I have with the Wide Lux is that with the swinging lens, it's going to be something that needs constant repairs. It's not something I could just chuck on the seat next to me. Let's be honest. It's not going to be the kind of camera that I can chuck on the seat next to me and just have it with me every day. And that's where I come to. If this question's really complex. I'm not just going to give you a one-word answer. I can't do it. I've got to give you the full answer, okay? when I think of a dream camera, it's got to be a camera that I'd be happy to have with me every single day. It's going to sit next to me on my chair when I drive to work and when I come home and when I go out and when I go to the shops to get a loaf of bread. It's there with me because it's my dream camera and I take it everywhere I go and it becomes synonymous with me and it lasts forever, okay? So then you think of what kind of cameras would you take with you forever? Me personally, I'm not going to take an expensive camera with me everywhere. I'm just not. It doesn't make sense to me to bring a $5,000 camera everywhere you go. It doesn't make sense. And the risk is too high. And I think if I was going to pick a camera that had to be synonymous with me and was going to be my one and only, you would have to have backups and copies. You couldn't just have one camera. You'd have to have multiple cameras. You would have to have a little stash of them. You know, maybe, especially if it's mechanical, you'd have to have maybe a few bodies for repair that you can use for parts. A couple that are functioning that are like almost mint and you just keep them in a box and you just make sure you just actuate them every now and then to make sure they're still functioning. Then you've got your actual beaters that you use every day and it becomes this, you know, circulation and you're constantly working on it. So it has to be something that I can have a few of, not just one. So that's where the Leica falls apart too. I need to earn about four or five of them to become my dream camera. So scrap that with the Leicas. So what cameras can I think of now that would then fit the bill of being my dream camera? Well, I'd probably look at the cameras I've already got and I'd probably say the Zorkies up there because I could easily get a whole bunch of bodies, Zorkie bodies for nothing and they would be great to just have pieces of for future reference. The Nikonos. Definitely the Nikonos. But for some reason, the Nikonos isn't as easy to just have with you all the time. It's bulletproof, which I love. Shoots film, which I love. It's all manual, which I love. It's very close to being the perfect camera. And not many people use it, so I suppose it could become synonymous with me being the... I could become the Nikonos guy. Right, and it's a stonkingly good lens on that thing. But you are limited with lenses. That's probably another thing to consider. And I love scale focus. I love scale focus. I'm not scared of it at all. Absolutely love it. I think it's a fantastic way to focus. But yeah, probably the Zorkie then, I suppose. Because there's lots of lenses to choose from. I absolutely adore the Jupiter lenses. I think they're absolutely fantastic. So, you know, yeah, my dream camera might be a simple Zorkie. And Zorkie's a camera that I can take everywhere. That I'm not going to be scared. If someone stole it, don't care. I've got six more at home. Doesn't matter. They get scratched. Doesn't matter. Drop it in the snow. Doesn't matter. Simple camera. There's always that element of surprise because you don't know if it's actually going to work or if it's just going to chew your roll apart. You know, all those kind of fun things. But the lens is just... I love that Jupiter 8 lens. So that could very well be my dream camera. That could be my beta, my everyday dream. Maybe I've already got my dream camera. Maybe that's what it, you know, and that's why these experiments are so good, because you really get to feel out what would be your dream camera. You know, what other mechanical camera could I get? Okay, so if Leica was out, maybe I could get a Voigtlander. I don't know. For some reason, Voigtlanders never really spoke to me. They don't do it for me. Okay, so scrap Voigtlander. Maybe I could get like a Nikon S2, like a rain, you know, yeah, that's kind of like but there's something about those cameras, they just don't feel the same as, yeah. Look, I absolutely love the Nikon, the Nissan rangefinders. I think they're absolutely gorgeous, regardless whether it's an S2, S3, or whatever they are. Whatever the names are, I absolutely love them. I think they look awesome. And just having a Nikon badge on it, it's just that little... And I'm sure the lenses are fantastic too. But same thing, if I was going to go a Nikon, I'd probably just go a Kiev. Like, especially the early modded Kievs that are pretty much identical copies of the contacts. And it's very high quality. And you're getting it for next to nothing, which means you could get a few extra bodies. And look, I'm really sorry, because I know the idea behind this premise is like to dream really big and to be like, you know, if you could have any camera in the world, what would be your dream camera? But in absolute reality, I just don't care about the, you know, being this really expensive camera, or this really, you know, special camera. I guess I would prefer to have heaps of cheap cameras. Like, let's say I had 10 Zorky bodies and 10 Zorky lenses. I'd prefer to have that than have, you know, one high quality camera. Because at least this way, I can switch things out. I can try different things. I could maybe, you know, tear one apart and try and rebuild it and do something crazy with it and put some ridiculous lens on it or something. And, you know, you've just got, I don't know, you've just got, and you end up being less precious about it. It's less precious. Hey, Bubs. And I think there's something to be said about cameras that are less precious. For me personally, each to your own, but for me, when I have got a camera that is not precious in my hands, it takes the pressure off. It really does take the pressure off for me. I don't feel like I've got to live up to the hype of this camera. I don't feel this pressure of, you know, wow, I've got an $8,000 camera, you know, I've got to make sure these pictures are worth it. Because, you know, can I tell you a story? I'm going to dig back into the catacombs of my mind and share a story with you. Okay, here it is. I'll try not to go on this tangent for too long, but here we go. Quick story. Many, many moons ago, I used to love riding like road bikes, racing bikes, like as in like bicycles, you know, like Tour de France, you know, many moons ago, right? I used to love Tour de France-y bikes kind of things. Anyway, one day I went out and I bought this awesome carbon fiber, top of the range, cost big bickies. It was my pride and joy. Absolutely loved it. And anyway, I'm riding down there was a freeway footpath along the river, and I'm just, you know, going for it and just loving life. I got my beautiful carbon bike. I'm feeling all pretty and prissy in my little outfit and everything. Everything's good. Everything's good, right? It's my dream. I achieved it, and it cost big bickies, right? And all of a sudden, this young little whippersnapper pulls up next to me on this bunky old Repco. Like, honestly, the bike would have been worth like $100 tops, right? And he pulls up next to me and he goes, "Hey man, nice bike, really nice bike." And I was like, "Yeah mate, hopefully one day you can, one day you might save up. Yeah, young boy, you save up and one day you might get one of these, you know, that's kind of the vibe I was giving him." Anyway, he goes, no, I used to have a carbon bike. And I was like, "Oh, really? I used to have one too, eh?" He says, yeah, but see, the problem is with carbon is once you have it, like an accident, if you drop it or something, it fractures the frame, and once it's fractured, it costs so much money to fix it. So ever since I broke that carbon frame, I've decided I'm just sticking to cheap stuff from now on, just sticking to cheap frames. If it smashes, I can just buy a new one tomorrow, and that's all I need. And I was like, wow, that's pretty interesting. And then anyway, he says, "Hey, forget about bikes. Let's ride, man. Let's hit the road. Let's go. Hey, do you want to, like, we'll tail each other and we'll, you know, let's see if we can get a really good cadence." It's a bit of the lingo, guys. I don't expect you to understand. But, you know, maybe we can get a good cadence going. We can, you know. And I said, "Hey, man, let's do it. Let's go, bro. Look at my bike. I'm winning, bro." So anyway, long story short, this guy completely waxed me. This guy was way out ahead. He was such a better rider than I was. He was faster. He was more consistent. Everything was better. And I'm just out at the back there, trying to keep up. And then, you know when you're exhausted and people, like, you're exercising and people are trying to have a conversation with you, and they're like, "Oh, so anyway, did you see?" And you're trying to talk but pretend that you're not completely out of breath. So you're like, "Yeah, mate, it was really good, mate. I loved it. It was fantastic. Yeah, I saw that." And the whole time you're just dying inside. So that was happening the whole time. And this kid, he was just blowing past me. He had endless energy. What's the point of this story? The point of this story is, it doesn't matter what you're shooting with. It doesn't matter what kit that you've got that you're using. It matters how good you are at using it. And if that's a chummy little Zorky camera that people laugh at and that's, you know, worthless and it's not even worth blah, 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 but you've got banger photos that you've taken with it and you can get good snaps. And let's be honest, you can get good snaps in any camera. But if you can get some banging snaps, then you're winning, man. You're winning. You don't need the fancy carbon camera. You don't need the top of the range. You don't need none of that stuff. You just need, you know, four chords and the truth, right? You just need the basics. So So that's why I prefer a cheaper camera. I don't care for the expensive stuff, because then it puts pressure on me and I'm thinking, well, if I've got an $8,000 camera, am I taking $8,000 photos? Oh, but it doesn't matter. It's just like, you know, it's whatever. What? Just to clarify, if you love $8,000 cameras, power to you. If that's what gets you up in the morning and it makes you feel good about who you are, I'm not going to take that away from you. I'm not going to say that you're wrong, because you're not. And power to you. But for me personally, I just want to focus on the photos. You know, I did once watch a YouTube channel ages ago. Don't know who the guy was, but he said, and this was really early in my photography journey, and of course, pearl of wisdom, right? Pearl of wisdom. He said, buy a cheap camera, buy the cheapest camera you can, and whatever money you had left over that you're going to spend on an expensive camera, use that money to go traveling, to take that camera to new places that you weren't going to go to. Do you see the wisdom there? Because if you go someplace that's amazing, you know, you track through the through a desert or something, the story, the images, it's going to be so much better than if you bought a really expensive camera and you just walked around the block that you live on and you take a picture of a light pole and then a stop sign and then just a car parked on a street. Like, who cares, right? Who cares? So, yeah, hope you've enjoyed this. What you got there, Das? Yeah, I hope you enjoyed this episode. Now, listen, this is part one. There's two more questions I want to answer that I think are really important. I've been also asked the question of, what have been your favorite cameras you've used so far? Now, you might say, well, that's obvious now, isn't it? It's obviously the Zorky. Not 100% true. There's actually some cool cameras that I've used. So I want to answer that. What's the coolest cameras I've used so far? What's my favorite cameras I've used so far? You know, obviously the Zorky will have a mention, but there's a whole bunch of others that I haven't spoken about for a long time. So there's that, and then the other question I want to answer, which I think's possibly the most interesting, is what cameras I'm using now, like what's actually in my collection now, and also why did I sell the cameras I sold? Okay, why did I sell the cameras I sold? Because I find it interesting when I watch someone's YouTube video and they're repping this camera, they're saying it's amazing, it's the best camera they've ever used, and then all of a sudden they sell it and you think, well, what happened there, mate? Were you just making content, or was there a problem? Is there something that you know that we need to know about? So I want to let you know the story of why I sold some of my big hitters, my heavy hitters. Why did I sell the Fuji X100F? Well, you didn't know about that? Why did I sell the X100F? Why did I sell the X-Pro1? Why did I sell all my Fuji gear? Why did I sell a bunch of Canon gear? Why did I sell my Nikon stuff? Why am I selling this stuff? Okay? There's stories behind all these cameras, and I want you to have a clear understanding of why I sold these cameras, because I think that's really worth talking about. So that'll be the following Q&A sessions, okay? So let's check them out together. If you have any questions, if there's any other thoughts you guys have, this can be an ongoing conversation that we can keep going back through. But I think I might leave it there. And, oh yeah. Dear travelers, and welcome back. Welcome back. Okay, outtake rant. I spoke about what my favorite film camera was, but I didn't mention what my favorite digital camera would be, or my dream digital camera would be. So I spoke about my dream film camera. But you might be asking yourself, well, what's his digital camera? Because I thought maybe he might be into some digital stuff too. Okay, good question. Good question, Ace. What would be my dream digital camera? Dream digital camera would be something that I've been thinking about for a while. I definitely want the X-Pro 1 back again. There's something about that camera. Definitely want an X-Pro 1. And I suppose the Epson RD1, that just seems perfect. Can you please check? The Epson RD1 just seems like it hits all the right boxes that you could ever dream from a digital camera that feels like a... Okay, sorry about that. Door closed. Yeah, the RD1 seems pretty damn cool. 5 megapixels, doesn't worry me too much. Plus the RD1 has that cool little like advanced shutter thing that's just awesome. So I'd say that's... And look, I know there's a few of you out there that are thinking, wait a second, that's built off one of those Voigtlander bodies. You said you didn't like it, but yeah, okay, relax. Okay, it's an Epson. Okay, it's a Voigtlander body, but the whole Epson thing, the whole thing that doesn't have a screen on the back, you can flip it. So it's just blank. It feels like a film camera. So yeah, Epson RD1 would be my dreamer. But again, you know, I would never spend that kind of money on a digital camera that I just know is going to die eventually. So it's just never going to happen. I'd say something like that. What other digital cameras would I dream of? I would love one day to try the Sony RX1. The RX1, the 35mm full frame, pocketable, around the microphone again, pocketable camera. Don't think it's pocketable at all, but that'd be pretty fun to at least try out, see what they're like. X-Pro 3 would be awesome too. Try something like that out. Digicam. Nothing else has really come into mind. I do miss my X100F. I do regret selling that. Don't regret selling all the Sigma gear. Oh my word, Sigma. You're so close to being perfect, but yet so far away. I'd say that's probably my answer for my dream digital camera. Again, not fussed about a Leica, just, you know, Leica whatever digital. I'm not saying they're not good, I bet you they're amazing, but something about them just don't gel with me. It just doesn't gel with me. But hey, power to anyone else that loves them and reps them, go for it. You're a champion, keep doing your thing. What other film cameras did I not mention that probably should get an honorable mention of my dream cameras? Okay, here we go. The Minolta TC1. That's a camera that I have just fawned over, frothed over for many years. I want one of those TC1s. They're tiny. They've got the Rokor G lens. The Minolta Rokor G, which, you know, those lenses are like $3,000 or something just for a lens. 28mm, it's pocketable, it's titanium. Boom! What's not to love? So I really, really, really do like those little pocketable cameras. But why I haven't pulled the trigger on one of them is pretty much the same thought of, you know, it's an extremely expensive electronic film camera. Hey, Bob.
Hi.
How you doing?
Good.